is to be prohibited if they are done abstemiously to a limit, to drink, that is a small bit, or to eat beef, just a small piece. So something which is abstemious is not going to be pernicious. So there is abstemious tank philosophy, there is hedonistic philosophy, there is instinctive justification philosophy, elephants are depressing the teeth, then why God has created fishes. So innumerable this type of justification of instincts and various things are there amongst the people. And there is extreme rigidity in one side, like Middle East philosophy, was extreme rigidity, extreme liberty in the other side. So we have a rational approach. That's why I addressed in one theism conference, the conference of theology, I told that we are the only country where there is choice, where there is chance, where there is rule for repentance and remediation, where there is a possibility for gradual upgradation, where there is a possibility for universal brotherhood, affinity, where there is a possibility for commercial embrace of God. Because we are also monotheistic in our religion. They are also monotheistic. But the difference is, we are rationally monotheistic and they are radically monotheistic. That is, radical monotheism is rational monotheism. See, God has created innumerable species. He cannot compel all people to talk a single language, to take a single food. Likewise, without making the person suitable to a divine model, compelling everybody without description or without discrimination or status analysis to worship a single God is idiocy and lunaticism. They cannot be compatible with that. So Krishna says in Bhagavad Gita, O Arjuna, I am the Supreme. I have installed different modes of worship as per the trimodal modular structure or configuration of people, Sattvika, Rajasa and Tamasa, goodness, passion and ignorance. On the basis of these three modes, I have installed religions, deities, worship model based on the geospecific gravity of their land, mind setup of their people, the philosophy of their livelihood behind that, the based on the food, the thought, association. So considering various other socio-demographic, religiographic, philographic positions of their land, I have designed different religions for them. So Arjuna, any person worshipping that religion, that sturdity, that conviction, that staunchness I am installing in them, gradually he finishes that, exhausting the status, he gradually approaches me and attains my abode. This what we call rational monotheism. There is only one God, but depending upon the variation that exists in the receptivity of innumerable workers, instead of compelling them to worship a single God, God has designed different worship modes according to their status and slowly upgrades them to reach Him. That is the greatness of our culture. That is known as the rational monotheism. This is what we call the greatness of our land. And God has created only these things. It is known as five organs. One is form, and second, if there is a form, there must be a system of worship. If there is a system, there must be a center of worship. If there is a center, there must be a rule of worship. If there is a rule to monitor that, there must be a team. So, having a form, having a system, having a center, rule and team, everything is made by God. But the team is organized by human handling. That is where all the corruption, all the contamination started. God assumed different forms. That is told in Shastras. Ajaya mamo babudha vijayate. He assumes different forms for our emancipation. He only created various systems of worship. Pancharatra and various agamas, they have been instructed only by Him. Even Shilpa Shastra and Nirmana, everything was initiated by Him, by His divine mercy, to great architects like Maya, Vishwakarma and Kashyapa. The rules of worship are also modified by Him. So everything He has done and handed over to human beings. When human beings started doing that in human handling, it has created in domination and suppression, malpractices, fraudulence and various other activities started. So we have to think and we have to revive this thing. That's what I used to say in one lecture I quoted. God handled demons like Prahlada and Vibhishana. When great demons like Prahlada and Vibhishana are handled by God Himself, they become better than the celestials and worshipable. When humans handle the same God, God handled the demons and made Him even more godly. When the same God is handled by humans, He will be worse than a demon. It will be a warehouse of all mistakes, errors, sins, offenses, and crimes. That's what we are seeing now because of human handling. See, who is affected? Number one, the public is affected. If a temple is mismanaged, the public is affected. So we have to get public supervision and vigilance. Second, those who are managing the temple, they are affected. Their progeny is affected. They have to go for supervision. The government is affected. Famine, flood, drought, natural disasters, lot of clashes, disharmony, everything comes out of mismanagement of divinity, the Shastras say. So they have to, government, they have to make for supervision. And we have to create a model which I call it as a KWS model. Knowledge, worship and service model. Our temples are just abodes of nonsense and nuisance. Everywhere shouting, no mantras are there. Everywhere except a temple you can get peace. That is the position today. So there must be knowledge. In whenever you insight, see what is the greatness behind the Islam, how they are integrated, because they are taught and trained properly. They are trained properly. The purpose may be different, I don't know, but they are taught and trained properly. So it should have a center for knowledge. Then after knowledge, they have to go to worship. Because knowledgeless worship is very, very simple and silly. After the worship, that should mature into service, making himself serviceable for others and service to others. So it is known as KWS model. At least we have to build a temple or take over a temple to do all of these things. Coming to the conclusive session, I want to say what are the positive hopes that we are having for the development of India Century Mission. Countries like Israel and Japan, you are seeing. Japan, after a very great Holocaust, still it is surviving and it has developed a lot because of the immigrated commitment and patriotic, productive patriotic or applied patriotic vigor of the citizens of the country. And Israel is also like that. It is good in administration. It is well established and administered in spite of all its allies and other forces, holistic forces, hostile forces. Everybody unanimously deciding to destroy Israel. Still they are developing because of their integrity. But India, in spite of disasters, in spite of political instability, border insecurity, internal insecurity, social evils and struggles, still it is surviving without even integrity, only because of the greatness of the people whose footprints are there in this land, not because of our area of our commitments. Because we are seeing developed countries developing because of visible patriotism and productive integrity, which we are not seeing here. So if we are developing by an unseen factor guidance. I don't know how long it will continue, how far we are going to make it continue. That is our role. We have to do that. That is the first thing. Second thing, they have mentioned about yoga. Yoga is very much essential. You see, what is the use of yoga? Yoga is useful for five major things which we call as Panchashakti. How to freeze, face and facilitate hurdles. There are three powers with hurdles. In problem mechanics they say, how to freeze hurdles. I cannot freeze it. Then how to face hurdles. More than that, how to facilitate hurdles, how to convert, how to manual your skill by hurdles themselves. So it is like waste recycling or waste productivity management, which we are calling now. So it is waste recycling. Like it is a process by which the crisis is recycled into comfort. So that power is only in yoga. But now what we are practicing is not that yoga. Making some asanas, just I called some people and asked them to demonstrate some yoga asanas. You know, yoga seminar, demonstrate like this. Then I asked, you are just giving the postures of a parrot, a rabbit, a bow and various other living and non-living things. If just for remaining 5 or 6 minutes in the portion, if you want to get some benefit or if you believe that you will get it, then that particular element is in that posture throughout its life. Marjanasana is the posture of a cat. You are putting the Marjanasana only for 2 or 3 minutes. But the Marjanasana cat is in that asana for throughout its life. It has to get more benefits. Unless it is culminated with Yama and Niyama, the principles of obedience in life, unless it is mixed with Dhyana, Dharana, the purpose or goal of life, then the postures make no difference between natural postures of those animals or those structures like bow. So yoga is practical yoga, no doubt asanas are the beginning. So we can face hurdles, facilitate and freeze hurdles, that is, free can maintain relations, how to forgive people, how to adjust with people, how to transform people. So there are three different areas and we are mismanaging. Wherever we have to forgive, we are struggling. Wherever we have to struggle, we are forgiving. So that to forgive, that to adjust. If somebody is, somebody's son is drinking, how we can forgive or how we can adjust? We have to transform. So mind has three powers. One is to transform others to their own level, to adjust if we are having some problems, or to control whenever it is required for somebody to be controlled. So it has the power to transform, it has the power to influence people and to bring something whenever adjustment or whenever tolerance or whenever some sort of achievement is impossible or unworthy. So that power is also there. Boosting of intellect, whenever we take a book and read or whenever you do something,